Of Myth and Mercy features adult topics and subject matter that some people may find disturbing. Listener discretion is advised. If you feel uncomfortable and need help, please contact your local crisis center. The North American Crisis Hotline numbers are listed in every episode description.
I'm Georgie.
I'm Kate.
And we are Nothing Rhymes with Murder.
Each week we hit up a new country and tell each other a true crime story from it, usually also whilst guzzling Prosecco.
Past trips have led us to the vampire of Krakow in Poland, the last witch burned in Ireland, and the boozing barber in Canada.
We don't like to leave you on a downer though, so we will give you some fun hotspots to visit also.
Absolutely, and you can find us wherever you get your podcasts, as well as at NRWM Podcasts on Twitter and Nothing Rhymes with Murder on Facebook and Instagram.
Yeah.
And remember, kids, life is a journey.
Just don't let murder stop you.
Okay, bye-bye.
Bye then.
Okay,
bye
goodbye,
now.
Bye, goodbye. Bye.
Hey, everyone, and welcome to another episode of Myth and Mercy. I'm Alice, and as always, I'm joined again by my partner in crime reporting, Cass.
Hi.
Today, we're covering a case that's pretty near and dear to my heart and to my home city of Jacksonville, Florida, the murder of Maddie Clifton in 1998. It's been almost 20 years since that tragedy, but Jacksonville is still feeling the repercussions of this senseless act of violence on a child by a child for reasons that you'll soon learn in this episode. In 1998, much like it is today, the Lakewood neighborhood of Jacksonville, Florida is a quiet area filled with working-class families. It's sandwiched right between the gentrifying San Marco area and the more working-class University Boulevard area, a place that I've driven through countless times, and I imagine if you wanted to visit it, you could drive through and not really think too much about it. The area has houses that are really simple and sort of homey, and there's tons of pine and oak trees everywhere.
Madeline Ray Clifton was born on June 17, 1990, to Sheila DeLongis Clifton, who went by Missy, and Steve Clifton. Madeline, who went by Maddie for short, was instantly inseparable and best of friends with Jessica, her older sister, who is older by just under 2 years. Maddie herself was described as a cheerful, well-behaved kid. She was described as polite and well-mannered, and while she was dedicated to taking piano lessons, super passionate about dancing and the classes that she was taking to learn it. The feminine aspects of her personality were balanced out with a veracity for touch football, hockey, and especially basketball, along with this inherent kind of tough-as-nails attitude that she reportedly had. Missy described her daughter by saying she could wear a ballerina outfit just as well as her soccer or her basketball stuff. Jessie said she was her big sissy, so even though Jessie wasn't a tomboy, Maddie still wanted to do what her older sibling did, and she was happy to do whatever her big sissy wanted to play or do. And at only 8 years old, her well-defined traits made Maddie a unique and just her presence hard to forget. As a family, the Cliftons were pretty typical in the whole two kids, and as Alice described it, it's kind of a generally picket fence, middle class, in a middle class neighborhood kind of environment she grew up in. Mostly, it was unremarkable, and it was comfortable in an American kind of goodness sort of way. I'd go so far as it's kind of like a neighborhood which is kind of like bedroom communities, since it's like a 20-minute or so drive to the city center or the metro area of Jacksonville. As far as working and their daily lives go, Steve was a foreman for a Jacksonville-based metal shop, and Missy and Steve had actually moved to Lakewood about 7 or so years before Maddie was born, or about 5 before Jessica, their first child, was born. The family was close, and they did what they could to make sure they spent a lot of quality time together, whether it was board games or other wholesome activities.
Across the street from the Cliftons was the Phillips household. Steve and Missy Phillips raised Joshua as best they could, although that's not really saying much, considering that Josh walked in on his father punching through a wall at least once. Josh's father believed that his son needed discipline, and he enforced that with an atmosphere of constant and vague menace, along with a variety of rules for the growing boy. Their financial situation wasn't great, which contributed to their really stressful situation. Surrounded by this environment, Joshua grew into a solitary child and later a teen. According to neighborhood children and parents, he was a pliant, if, again, solitary kid. That said, he had a darker side, one that would really only be revealed later, after what we're soon going to talk about. He had managed to get his hands on some pornography, which was a little bit harder back in the day than it is now. Some of it, of course, unfortunately, was violent, and a few books on the occult. Things that, while not in themselves harmful, certainly indicated that there was more to this baby-faced teen than met the eye. Perhaps more troublingly, Josh had a more local obsession. Jessie Clifton, Maddie's 11-year-old sister, the family that lived right across the street.
The evening of November 3rd, 1988, seemed pretty usual and par for the course. At 4:30, Maddie had come home from school, practiced piano, and then at around 6:30, she went out to play. Watching the scene was a neighbor who first saw Maddie go to a 16-year-old neighbor's house, or into his yard, and she soon returned, though, to her own yard. Then the neighbor watched Joshua Phillips, quote-unquote, creeping up on Maddie. For a few moments, she saw them playing without an issue, and then the neighbor witness went about her other chores, which kept her from viewing the kids or from the window. But Maddie had come home from school earlier, practiced piano, and then around 4:30, she went out to play. At 6:20, Missy began to call her children back to the house for dinner. Jessie came as requested, but Maddie was nowhere to be found. Less than 15 minutes later, overwhelmed with panic, Mrs. Clifton rang the police to report her 8-year-old daughter missing. Maddie, who is a well-behaved kid and would check in and was not the type to up and disobey curfews or rules or anything like that, she had to be in danger because this just wasn't like her. Almost immediately, the search for the missing girl began, with huge amounts of people dedicating themselves to the effort. Neighbors, officers, and investigators from the Jacksonville Sheriff's Department began searching with the family across Lakewood and nearby areas. Amongst the search teams was 14-year-old Joshua Phillips, wearing a mask of obliviousness to the girl's fate and final moments. A few days passed, and the FBI got involved, since there was no sign or evidence of Maddie being discovered anywhere. With no leads and no theories and no ideas, what happened to her was a mystery to everyone, or so it seemed. Her father, Steve, recalled it being like, it was like she shut the door and just poof, vanished off the face of the earth. And for a long, emotional, and grueling week, his baby girl, Maddie, was nowhere to be found. A neighbor who had a history of sexual battery and two arrests from more than 15 years prior was suspected, interrogated, and actually submitted to a polygraph test. The man, Larry Grisham, failed the polygraph but was able to provide a confirmable alibi. With his vile criminal history and his lie detector results showing deception, proof he was not involved was really confusing for law enforcement, families, and friends alike. And of course, those who loved Maddie were suspicious of Grisham anyway. Law enforcement was searching through local spots like parks, buildings, construction zones, dense foliage, neighborhood homes, vehicles, everywhere they could, including the neighborhood across the street, the Phillips home, where Josh Phillips lived. And they did notice a strange smell at the Phillips residence, but who hasn't gone into an unfamiliar home and smelled it and kind of like notice that it smells different or odd or just unfamiliar? And maybe that's just how the place smelled, so they didn't really think anything of it. So they continued their fervent search across Jacksonville without any luck until a week later, November 10th, exactly a week after Maddie had disappeared into thin air, Melissa Phillips, Josh's mom, stumbled upon a horrifying reality. She went to clean her teenage son's room because it started to reek more and more, and as moms do, they sometimes take it upon themselves to eliminate messes. The stench was paramount now, and his constant incense burning was failing to disguise it. And it was when she entered the room and noticed his waterbed appeared to be leaking. The various air fresheners, roll of tape, baseball bat behind the dresser, Leatherman's pocket knife present, none of that really caught her attention, but the puddle that was pooling up on the floor did. And at first, Melissa thought this might be a leak on the waterbed that's causing all the stench, maybe like mold or dampness. But upon a closer inspection, she noticed that there was a kind of a broken sideboard that had been haphazardly like taped back in place. When Melissa rattled the board loose, she found one of the worst discoveries anyone could make. Underneath a sheet of plywood, which supported the mattress on the bed, she saw a child's foot. Melissa immediately ran out of her home as fast as she could, overflowing with terror. See, even if Josh is her beloved son and her immediate kin, her little boy, like, she knew she had to tell someone what she had found. So without hesitation, she flagged a police officer down that was in the neighborhood still canvassing as they hadn't given up quite yet. And she reported to him what she had found. When they arrived, Melissa stated, "I just pointed where they needed to look. I couldn't even go in." And the police, well, they found the decomposing, battered body of Maddie shoved underneath Joshua Phillips' mattress. Police notified Melissa and then began to tape off the crime scene encircling the Phillips residence. The investigation now had a target location, and they began their exhaustive search for evidence. Simultaneously, law enforcement went to Josh's school, picked him up, and immediately booked him at the local juvenile detention center. And upon arrival, Joshua Phillips confessed to police what he had done. He didn't hesitate or hold back the tale of what happened, though it didn't seem like he had given an actual discernible reason why. Jessie, Maddie's sister, who was at home with police officers, remembers them taking her down the street to the IHOP after Maddie had been discovered. At first, she wasn't sure why, but they had brought her there due to the news and wanted to comfort the young girl before they let her know that her sister was no longer with them. In retrospect, Jessie said, "As an 11-year-old, you think about toys, games, and most of all, your family and friends."
At around 5 p.m. on November 3rd, Maddie had gone over to Josh's house to play baseball, just a kid wanting to have fun after school. Josh was home, but his parents weren't, and he wasn't allowed to have friends over without his parents being at home. Like many teenage boys, however, he wanted to play and started sort of throwing the ball around with Maddie. A throw went wide and hit her above the eye, drawing blood. And of course, she was only 8, so she started crying almost immediately, because she's a little kid. This is where Josh's accounting of events after he was arrested and where the forensics first begin to diverge. According to the teen, he panicked since he wasn't supposed to have any friends over, and his dad was going to be home any minute now. He brought Maddie, who was still crying, into his house. From there, he says that he carried her to his room and put her on the floor, but she was obviously still in pain and she still continued to cry. And that's the moment when things took a sudden and terrible turn for the worst. In Josh's words, he panicked and hit her once or twice on the head with a nearby baseball bat to silence her, and then stabbed her repeatedly in the throat with his penknife. And once the girl was silent, he shoved her in the space in his waterbed frame between the floor and the mattress and, of course, tried to mask the worsening stench for a week. But what actually happened? According to forensics, she was injured in the head, presumably due to the errant baseball, but the rest of the evening is very different. Once Maddie was in Josh's room, he took a phone cord and strangled her with it for almost 15 minutes. Then, he hit her on the head with his baseball bat and shoved her motionless body inside the waterbed frame. Around this time, Josh's dad came home, and Josh left his room to talk to him for a bit, acting as if nothing was wrong. Talked for a little bit and came back. Returning to the room, Josh saw that Maddie was still alive and moaning in pain from under his bed. Pulling the mattress up, he then stabbed her 9 times in the body and 2 times in the neck, finally killing her. There was no evidence of sexual assault, but Maddie's body was found naked from the waist down, other than a pair of white socks. And investigators also found that both before and after the murder, Josh watched pornography. So make of that what you will.
That's fucking gross. 4 days later, Madeline Clifton was put to rest at Oaklawn Cemetery off of San Jose Boulevard, not far from her home. 4 days later, it was made known that the murderer, Josh, had confessed and was being detained. 4 days later, the neighborhood found themselves shaken up and disturbed greatly, a feeling that wouldn't go away for a long time, if ever. As more time passed, the story of Maddie Clifton was not forgotten. The incident was one that touched people across Jacksonville and is a tale of caution every resident knows and shares with their kids to reinforce safe actions like calling home, playmate rules, and so forth. Eventually, the tragedy splintered the Clifton family as Missy and Steve divorced. Jessie, Maddie's older sister, was kept in the dark about the murder and the details of the case until she was almost 16 years old. And she recalls how drastically her life changed after her sister went missing. Huge changes and just horrible experiences, trauma, emotional damage, and just that vacancy like in her heart where her sister's presence was supposed to be. And journalists, the press, and the media, like, they went apeshit. They went nuts. courts had to actually enforce a gag order, which went into effect November 20th of the same year, 1998, to limit access to that the media had to the suspect, trial participants, families, and even investigators. The Florida Times Union opposed the gag order in a legal motion. They were insisting that it wasn't necessary. They came with a list of reasons why it was frivolous. And it was just in hope that they could get access that they were starved for. They wanted the juicy details. They wanted a juicy article to be put out. The more information they could get, the better they could sell their paper and make money. The Times Union was railing against a couple statements that the gag order stated. The first one being, since the inception of events leading to the charges in the case, the media has devoted an extraordinary amount of coverage to the persons and events associated with it. And the second, defendant has indicated his intent to exercise his right to a trial. These media reports have on numerous occasions contained statements by various persons regarding physical, testimonial, or behavioral evidence which may or may not be admissible at trial, and which, particularly if not admissible, would be prejudicial to the defendant's ability to obtain a fair and impartial jury in trial.
State Attorney Harry Shorstein asked the Duval County Grand Jury to return a first-degree murder indictment against Phillips for his crime. A first-degree conviction would lead to an automatic life sentence without parole. And if he was tried as an adult, he'd have the maximum penalty of life in prison. If he was tried as a juvenile, he would be possibly free in a few years. Surprising absolutely no one who is familiar with Florida's judicial system, he was tried as an adult. The trial was moved out of Duval County in April officially due to the immense amount of publicity that the crime generated. The first time something similar had happened in over 15 years. Chief Assistant Public Defender Bill White said, quote, "It got to the point where the community adopted Maddie Clifton. Picking the jury from the adopted family of the victim is a difficult thing to do. I don't know of anyone who thinks that would be fair." The defense attempted to suppress Josh's confession, stating that while Josh had given the statement in the presence of his father, he had, quote, "affirmatively stated that he thought he needed a lawyer." However, the detectives proceeded to encourage the defendant to give a statement before having an opportunity to consider the matter further or confer with an attorney. It didn't work. He was convicted and sentenced to life without the possibility of parole.
In 2002, Joshua Phillips' father died in a tragic car accident. And the news media across the nation published the event, and basically, even though the trial had been over years before, it proved that the public eye remained on both the Cliftons and the Phillips families. And though the latter was more under a meticulous and somewhat spiteful scrutiny, Joshua and his family continuously filed appeals, with Joshua himself publicly expressing deep regret, sorrow, and conveying what he learned, what he knew, what he felt, and while maintaining excellent, even above and beyond what the best prisoners exhibit while incarcerated. He took a lot of college classes and participated in any self-improving focused activities he could. He also attended therapy with a mental health professional consistently. 6 years after the murder of Maddie Clifton, her killer, Josh Phillips, said, "She was a little girl who didn't have to die." Jacksonville Sheriff in 2008, Nat Glover, stated, "I know some people thought the sentence was appropriate, but that was a tough sentence for someone that young. I never got the feeling that it was a malicious, mean-spirited, or calculated murder. It was kind of an impulsive act that, given a different set of circumstances, would never have happened." The same year, Harry Shorstein, who was state attorney for Florida at the time, commented, "It was a draconian sentence. If there were a case for executive clemency or parole, I would support it. Not for it to be done today, but for consideration of the life sentence."
In 2012, big changes came around that would not only affect Joshua, but thousands of inmates around the United States. In Miller v. Alabama, the U.S. Supreme Court ruled that mandatory life sentences without the possibility of parole for juveniles are unconstitutional. Up to 2,300 cases worldwide were affected due to this ruling. In 2015, Phillips' lawyers sort of began to consider the Supreme Court decision as a basis to file a resentencing hearing. However, at the time, Maddie's mom said, "Josh did get a life sentence, but Maddie got the death sentence. She was only 8 years old. He should not be cut a deal just because he was 14. A resentencing hearing was scheduled for February 2017, which was then postponed to June 2017. Josh said, quote, "I had no clue what life meant, what death meant, nor the depths of suffering that would follow one act. I had no inkling of how long suffering could last. I've lived long enough to understand what really suffering was. I did something horrible and I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry. Even now, after all these years, it's just so unfathomable that all this could have occurred. It tears my mind to know that I stole such precious life from you, from the world. I wish I could take away your pain. However, on November 17th, 2017, Josh was officially resentenced to life in prison. Now, this case sort of strikes me so close to home because I was an 8-year-old girl in Jacksonville when Maddie disappeared, and every Jacksonville local that I questioned about it, who lived in the area in 1998, they remember the events of that too, even though they might only remember it as, oh, that big story. I mean, depending on who you ask. My parents were just like, oh yeah, you should cover that, that's real rough. And of course, people my age were just like, oh man, I remember it being sort of a big deal.
I remember, like, I had a boss at one point when a job I had, like, 10 years ago, and she, I guess, lived in the neighborhood when it happened, and she knew the boy and his family. And, like, I remember, like, her saying that much, but I'm not from Jacksonville, so I was completely aloof. Like, ask me about Elizabeth Smart. I can get you on that. But, like, Maddie, I knew I heard about it, you know what I mean? But, like, people talk about it here, and they anticipate everyone to know it, so you can tell it's definitely, like, a Jacksonville thing. Like, it's something that, you know, I was all... Yeah, and so to me, I'm like, what? I don't know what she's talking about. That sounds horrible. That's all I could remember thinking, because that's all I knew.
It's a hometown case. Especially for Lakewood, it's a very working class, like, you know, I won't say good old boy neighborhood, but it's in the good old boy part of Jacksonville. I mean, it just, the fact that it was so brutal, and just literally from the kid next door, people still remember it as, oh man, that was so bad. I mean, Jacksonville's not a town where a whole lot of things happen, for good or bad.
Well, I don't know about that.
that's accurate. I think it was an unpleasant surprise. And I think that's part of why the Times Union, like, latched onto it. Because, I mean, you could say that they just wanted to push issues, and that's true. But at the same time, I also think that the people who lived there, where they were just like, what the hell just happened? And they wanted all the details they could get. And before, you know, really everyone had internet, or at least such open access to internet, that was how you got salacious details. There weren't true crime podcasts. There weren't, you know, really, you know, there wasn't Twitter to check for all the details. So just people wanted to know the rough details.
Yeah.
But that said, I guess we should mention that there were, I won't say there are good things that have happened, but the people who've been so negatively affected by this event, they've done good things.
Right.
But the experience. Camp Maddie is offered, it's a 3-day therapeutic camp for children aged 7 to 17 who have experienced grief due to homicide. It's held in May at the YMCA's Camp Immokalee location. I apologize if I mispronounced that. With an annual population of around 60 kids, they provide support and services to participants, which is fantastic. And if her life hadn't been stolen away from her 2 decades ago, Maddie would have been 28 years old this summer. Her big sister, Jessie, is reportedly in school to become a nurse, or at least she was whenever the recent sing and things happened. And looking at the time frame, she's probably working as a nurse now. Mm-hmm. Her big sister, and Jessie, had also continued being an avid dancer and athlete in acrobatics, such as cheerleading, crediting her involvement to her little sister. She ended up becoming an NFL cheerleader for the Jacksonville Jaguars, woo, who call their cheer squad Roar. And she alluded to this as an homage to her little sister's passion for dance, and that her sister's love for dancing inspired Jessie herself, as well as Maddie's love of football. She said it helped her make her feel like she was close to Maddie, and Jessie also used dance as a vehicle for coping with the grief and stress of losing her little sister in such a tragic way. And being able to do what she knew her sister loved, and close relation of football and sports, also really increased the bond she felt with her deceased sister. So what are your thoughts, Cass, on life in prison without the possibility of parole for juveniles?
I don't like it.
Yep.
I mean, like, yep. I understand that we have this need for wanting, you know, justice or whatever. And I could go on about that forever. But I think that our system that should be focused on rehabilitation anyway. So what's the incentive in, you know, rehabilitating yourself if, you know,
you're never getting out?
Right. And if you're rehabilitated, you can actually help and function and, you know, help society, which is way better than just leaving somebody in jail. It does not, there's no closure that, you know what I mean? There's no closure or justice that comes with that. Then you're just, no one's coming back. And that's the unfortunate part. So why not make a better situation out of a bad one? You know what I mean? And instead of sacrificing people to just a system that doesn't help. Or, I mean, our recidivism rates alone are more awful, whether you're a teenager or not. psychology's already told us that people under, 18 don't understand the full breadth and consequence of their actions.
Well, because your brain is still developing.
Yeah.
Just, it's not even a quote-unquote software problem where a person has an issue. It's the hardware problem.
Mm-hmm.
Just your brain hasn't developed the, if I do X, then Y will happen, which is largely why kids make so many terrible decisions. Mm-hmm. I know, as a child who made many terrible decisions, that somehow led me here being, alive and kicking.
Mm-hmm.
It was just, it's hard because obviously no one wants to say, yes, let's let the child killer on the street. Because mm-hmm. that's not what we're saying.
Yeah,
obviously, if a person commits a crime, they should be held accountable. But at the same time, it's really hard. I guess this is probably why I'm not a judge. Because I would just spend the whole time being like, life is terrible. Humans are scum. I guess I wish I had something more uplifting to say about this case. Like, it just proves that light can be found even in darkness. But the only takeaway that I get from this is that this just proves to me just how fragile what we consider normal life to be mm-hmm. is. Like, everything was fine. These people lived a perfectly normal life. They went to school, they came home, they played. It was, an Andy Griffin show kind of neighborhood where every kids are safe, things are fine. And then even Josh had, to be fair, a really garbage childhood. But, he was a normal kid doing normal kid things. And then whether he intentionally planned this out, which I don't think he did. I'm a big fan of Hanlon's Razor, which I will, if you're not familiar with, I'll explain it. It's more or less never attribute to malice what can be just as easily attributed to stupidity. Mm-hmm. I think the British version of that is cock-ups before conspiracy.
Right.
I don't think that Josh was this criminal mastermind. I think he was a dumb, stupid-ass kid who just somehow made the worst decision possible. And that led to all these people's lives just being forever shattered. I mean, Maddie's family, her parents divorced mm-hmm. after the trials
right.
because, I mean, shit, people divorce for way less. Like, a daughter getting murdered by your next door neighbor? Yeah, I could buy that. I could buy that killing a marriage. Just, it's rough.
Right.
What do you think?
No, I understand that. I can get behind that.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's ridiculous. I mean, I think it would, at the same time, be really silly to think that we should put a 16-year-old away for 2 years because he's an adult to let him out. But I also don't think, saying you're 16 years old and you never see the light of day outside of these prison walls again. Like, that's not mm-hmm. going to help anyone.
And it's, yeah.
Yeah.
It's just rough because I feel like our sentencing laws and the way that we approach criminality and crime,
mm-hmm.
I feel like it lags so far behind what our current understanding of psychology actually is.
Mm-hmm.
And, I understand that you can't treat, although you should, you can't treat, every case. You can't, sit down and have a psychologist, profile them and figure out, not to be crass, but how fucked in the head they are.
Mm-hmm.
I'd say this lovingly as someone who is fucked in the head. At the same time, just so many of our sentencing laws are based on this on incorrect, prejudicial, or racist understandings
right.
of criminality.
Understood. No, I agree. On some level, I definitely agree with that. I just wish that there was. I can't offer this perfect alternative idea, but I know what I don't. I know it's not working, and it's our judicial system or our know, criminal justice system, and that it's just not working. So I can tell you what's not working. I can tell you how to fix it, admittedly. But there are so many better options, and you see so many countries that are so much more successful than we are as far as rehabilitating and mm-hmm. lowering crime, and we're embarrassing. We're an embarrassment.
I feel like if you're going to just say, hey, you fucked up, now you're literally never going to, be able to live among the free population. If we are just giving up on rehabilitation, why not just, well, I guess this is a false equivalency, but to me, why don't we just, do the death penalty. Like, if that's the commitment that we're going to try and do, which is not even try to rehabilitate that,
but yeah, why but even they get pretend? All the appeals and, like, let's face it. And, you know,
I know it's me because I'm just extremely dramatic. You know that.
But at the same time, though, I get what you mean. It's like, it's literally, we're spending so much more money keeping people incarcerated instead of letting them come be another contribute, you know, make it up and be a contributing part of society. But we're just, like, too stubborn about that. And like I said, I really challenge what a lot of people consider justice rather than vengeance, because I feel like human nature tends to mistake vengeance in the terms of justice. So people want vengeance. People want people to suffer and be punished, you know, instead of, you know, be punished, you know, and pay back society or, you know, get rehabilitated. They'd rather that person suffer like so-and-so did. But that doesn't improve anything either, you know?
Yeah, it makes a bad situation worse, because there's literally nothing that you can get from. Like, an important caveat I think that we should say, and I know you feel the same way, is that we are in no way diminishing the effects of crime. Like, what happened to Maddie
was a travesty. Horrific. Yeah, like, it's not okay.
Yeah, if you put it in a horror movie, people are like, no, that's too far, man. Like, I guess it's, I wish I had the answers. But if I did, I probably wouldn't be sitting here on the floor of my closet talking about it.
We'd be rich and we'd probably be like part of the system, which is kind of a bummer.
Yeah, so.
But we'd be rich.
Another really uplifting episode from Alice and Cass.
Yay! Big news. Our next episode is going to be the end of our first season.
Woo, woo, woo.
And I'm going to talk about the time that I almost became fodder for a wannabe serial killer in it. Finally, almost gonna go down that route.
Only counts and horseshoes and hand grenades. That is what I've learned in life. My dad told me
that. Wait till the story starts. Then maybe you'll understand the almost.
Oh, boy.
Have you heard of, told you this, Alice?
No, okay. I'm really glad that you didn't get murdered by a serial killer. I mean, I feel like that should be, like, unsaid. Like, I feel like I should say that in every conversation.
Well, he wasn't a serial killer yet, but he was aiming for it. Let's leave it at that.
I know you can't see the face that I'm making.
You can edit this part out, but, like, I'll
No,
tell
we're
you
keeping
that.
It. We're keeping it. Oh, boy. Anyway. So, right. Yes. A baker's dozen for our first season.
New branding. We're going to have a whole bunch of new stuff. And as
it
I mentioned.
It is so schnazzy.
Lots of upgrades to our systems and everything. We've been listening to, you know, your feedback. So hopefully you'll love it.
We love and appreciate everyone who sent us feedback. Except for the one guy who was disappointed that I'm not the famous Alice Cooper.
Thank you to him too. Because that's still providing laugh.
I appreciate the laugh, and I also have changed my Twitter handle accordingly. I'm still at @omam_Alice, but you can see me as Fake News Alice, because I'm committed to offering only the finest fake news for listeners.
Yay.
But that said, do you want to explain what our season finale is going to be, or shall I?
So, this is our 12th episode. So, like I said, our 13th will be the final episode of our season. Well, we have had technically 14, but one was a two-parter, so we're counting this one. Because we're in charge here. What are you going to do? You're not a supervisor. Anyway. Our season finale is about a retired police commander who coerced false confessions out of over 330 people through acts of violence and cruelty. And they're really gory kind of ways, but we'll cover most of them, if not all of them.
In a tasteful way.
Yeah. He's now enjoying his pension, by the way, in his retirement here in Florida. Left Chicago to all of his indiscretions to pay for it. And so far, the taxpayers of Illinois have shelled out over $15 million in settlements and reparations for what former police detective John Burge and his quote-unquote midnight crew, as they were called, his rogue group of detectives, made a scandal of such proportions. You might be thinking it's made up, but we'll go over that next time.
So buckle in, guys. I don't really know what to follow up with that. Just buckle in, because it's going to be a doozy.
Yep. Have a good one, everyone. Stay safe.
Hello, guys. I'm Tim. Do you like conspiracies, UFOs, aliens, ghosts, and cryptids? Check me out at Paranormal Report. Go to paranormalreport.us. That's paranormalreport.us. Do you want to be a part of the show? Go to paranormalreport.us and join my Discord. You can also follow me on Twitter. And as always, I take suggestions on topics of what to cover on the show. That is paranormalreport.us. Now let's get back into the show.
Thank you for listening. Of Myth and Mercy is available on Stitcher, Google Play, and iTunes. Check us out on ofmythandmercy.com, Twitter, Facebook, Tumblr, and Patreon. Post-production wizardry and music composition by the maniacal genius Aaron Henry.